Good morning, friends. Today we are going to discuss about Puccinia, which is another type that we have to study under the subdivision Basidiomycotina. Now, this is a systematic position of Puccinia. It belongs to the division Amastigomycota, subdivision Basidiomycotina, order Uridinales, and family Puccinaceae. Now, Puccinia, it is a Basidiomycetous fungus, commonly known as rust, because of the rusty patches it produces on the stems and leaves of host plants. It is an obligate parasite, since it can thrive only upon living hosts. Now, Puccinia asparagi, it completes its life cycle on a single host called as asparagus, hence it is called as an otaceous fungus. Whereas Puccinia graminis, it completes its life cycle on two different host plants, namely wheat and barberry, and hence is called as heterotaceous fungus. Now, there are different species of Puccinia which cause different types of diseases. Like Puccinia graminis, it causes black rust or stem rust. Puccinia glamarum, it causes yellow rust or stripe rust. Puccinia triticina, it causes brown rust or orange leaf rust. Now, these are the appearances of Puccinia, and this is the stage on barberry leaf, and this is the stage on wheat. Now, we are going to discuss about Puccinia graminis today. Now, Puccinia graminis, as I told you earlier, that it causes black rust of wheat in almost all wheat growing areas of the world. It also attacks a large number of other hosts such as oats, barley, rye, and many other wild grasses. Puccinia graminis is heterotaceous, as the life cycle is completed on two different hosts, that is wheat and barberry. The dicaryophase of the life cycle, it is completed on the wheat plant, whereas the haplophase is completed on the barberry plant. Wheat is the primary host and barberry is the alternate host. Wheat is the primary host upon which the dicaryophase of the pathogen is completed, and this phase consists of a dikaryotic mycelium and two spore stages, namely the uridinal stage and the telial stage. Primary infection, it starts with the germination of acidiospores, which are formed in the barberry plant, and the infection starts with the germination of these acidiospores on wheat leaves. Now, acidiospores are binucleate. When they fall on the wheat plant, they germinate to produce a branched mycelium in the wheat plant tissues and spreads in the intercellular spaces. The cells of the hyphae in this mycelium are binucleate. The dikaryotic mycelium reproduces by producing two kinds of spores, namely the uridospores and teleutospores. They are produced on the surface of host tissue on specialized structures called as sori, namely uridosori carrying uridospores and teleutosori carrying teleutospores. Now, regarding the uridinal stage, the hyphae of the mycelium aggregate to form a hyphal mass near the surface of the infected leaf, stem, etc. And these hyphal mass, they surround host cells to form uridia. From the uridium, a large number of uridospores arise. Now, this group of uridospores thus formed is called as a uridosaurus. The uridospores are produced on long stalks, and each spore is binucleate, somewhat round or oval in shape and with a rough wall. The epidermis breaks and the uridospores are liberated. Under favorable conditions, uridospores germinate and again form uridosauri. So this cycle goes on. This is the asexual reproduction. Now, the infection due to uridospores can be seen as reddish brown pustules on the leaves and stem of wheat plant. Hence, the uridinal stage is often called the red stage or the summer stage. So, this is a uridosaurus, and you can see the uridospores coming out of the epidermis, and the scanning electron microscope shows the nature of the uridospores also. Now, the telial stage, which is formed during the late growing season, hyphal mass that gave rise to Uridia and Uridosaurus. It turns into Teleutosaurus, producing Teleutospores or Teleospores. The same hyphal mass which has given rise to the Uridosaurus now gives rise to the Teleutosaurus. The red stage or the summer stage, it is gradually replaced by the black stage or the winter stage. Teleutospores, they get exposed when the host epidermis breaks. Teleutospores are biceled, dark brown or black with cleavage shape and thick and smooth walls. Teleutospores are slightly constricted at the cross wall between the two cells. Each cell of the teleutospore is binucleate and has a germ pore. The two nuclei within each cell of the teleutospore fuse, and in this condition the teleutospore tides over winter. So these are the photographs showing the formation of Teleutosaurus carrying the teleutospores. You can see the teleutospores are biceled with a constriction, median constriction. Now the basidial stage, in the following spring, with the return of the favorable conditions, the teleutospores germinate. Each cell of the teleutospore produces a promycelium. Promycelium is also called as phragmobasidium, and it comes out of the germ pore. The diploid nucleus, it passes into the promycelium and divides meiotically, forming four haploid nuclei, of which two are of plus type and two are of minus type. Now these four nuclei, they get separated by the formation of septa. Now each of the four cells produce a sterigma, and at the end of it, later a basidiospore is produced. Basidiospores do not germinate on the wheat, but germinate on the second host or the secondary host, that is the barberry plant. So you can see that Uridospores, they have gradually given rise to the teleutospores, and each cell of the teleutospore now germinates to produce a phragmobasidium, and from the phragmobasidium the basidiospores are produced. Upon the leaf of the barberry plant, the basidiospore germinates by producing a germ tube and spreads in the host tissue by forming monokaryotic mycelium. Several basidiospores of both strains, plus and minus, they infect the same barberry leaf, and the mycelia of both types are produced in the same leaf. They produce pycnidial stage on the upper surface and ascidial stage on the lower surface. So you can see in this figure, on the upper surface the pycnidia are produced, and on the lower surface ascidia are produced. The pycnidia or the pycnia, they carry spermatia and the receptive hyphae, whereas the ascidia on the lower side, they produce ascidiospores. Pycnidial or the spermogonial stage, the monokaryotic mycelium now begins to organize itself beneath the upper epidermis of the barberry leaf and forms a dense mat. From this mycelium mat arise groups of hyphae which organize themselves into pycnidium. The pycnidia are of the plus and minus strains. Pycnidium is also called as spermogonium and is a flask shaped structure that opens to the outside by a small opening or a pore called as osteole, and is in turn guarded by sterile hyphae called as periphyses. There are two kinds of hyphae in a pycnidium: long and delicate receptive hyphae which protrude beyond the osteole, and the short spermatial hyphae arranged in a palisade like layer lining the cavity. Spermatial hyphae bear spermatia or pycnospores at their tip. So again, the figure showing the pycnidia on the upper surface carrying spermatia and the receptive hyphae. Spermatia, it is a small non-motile oval cell with a large nucleus. A pycnidium gives rise to either plus or minus spermatium only. The transfer of spermatium from one pycnidium to another is effected by insects. Insects transfer spermatium from one strain to the pycnidial cups containing receptive hyphae of the opposite strain. A binucleate cell is formed by the fusion of the spermatium with the tip cell of the receptive hyphae. From this binucleate cell, a dikaryotic mycelium is formed. The hyphae with dikaryotic cells collect together and form the acidia on the lower surface of the barberry leaf. Acidia are cup-shaped structures in which acidiospores are produced in basipetal succession, alternating with small intercalary cells called as disjunctors. Acidiospores are liberated by disintegration of the intercalary cells. The hyphal cells at the periphery become thick and form peridium surrounding the acidium. A mature acidiospore is binucleate, thick-walled, and usually subglobose to polyhedral in shape. The liberated acidiospores or acidiospores are carried by air to the wheat plant where they start the infection again. So this is the figure showing the structure of a acidia carrying the acidiospores. Now the life cycle of Puccinia graminis, can see that the primary infection, it starts with the acidiospores or acidiospore, and it is done on the wheat plant on the leaves or on the stem, and there the uridospores are produced inside the uridia, and again this uridospores can be produced by asexual cycle. Later in the winter, the uridia turn into teleutosauri. The uridosaurus turn into teleutosaurus, and the teleutosaurus produces teleutospores. These teleutospores are bicelled. Each cell contains two nuclei which fuse together, and from each cell of the bicelled teleutospore, a phragmobasidium is produced, and on the phragmobasidium, basidiospores are produced, and these basidiospores, they infect the secondary host, which is the barberry plant. On the barberry plant, the plus and the minus strains both are produced, both produce mycelium, and they produce two types of pycnidia, plus type pycnidia containing plus type spermatia and plus type receptive hyphae, and minus type pycnidia containing minus type spermatia and minus type receptive hyphae. The plus type spermatia, it fuses with the minus type receptive hyphae of the minus type pycnidium, and thereby bringing about dikaryotization. And this dikaryotic hypha, which is produced, it spreads on the barberry leaf, and it produces the acidia on the lower surface. Again, the acidia produces acidiospores, and this is ready for the next round of infection. Thank you.